This week, we have three very interesting webinars lined up for you, and we hope you can make it to the one that interests you the most. The first one is all that you need to know about bonds. The second one will discuss the pension scheme, OPS versus UPS versus NPS. And the last and final one will discuss SIP versus lump sum. We hope to see you all there.
Today, I'm going to open this topic for discussion on this channel, and we are asking Subhra what he thinks about SIP and DRIP in isolation and how he thinks we can get the most out of both of these. Subhra, what are your thoughts?
If you look at most of the people, when they talk about performance or outperformance of a share vis-a-vis the Sensex, they don't consider the TRI of the Sensex, nor do they consider the total return that you have got from a particular share. Some shares need money for growth, so fairly obvious they will not be able to pay high dividends. But some companies have enough money for their own internal requirements of growth and they have a surplus, they pay out dividend. Some companies have reached a stage where they have no need for money. For example, if you are a top toothpaste manufacturer with a strong brand, you just no need further money. Because if they need to create capacity, say in Northeast, they don't put up their own plant. They go to an entrepreneur there and say, we will buy this toothpaste from you at 8 rupees or 10 rupees, including packing and everything. So you buy land, you hire people, you buy the machinery. We will help you through the process with HR, everything. But we don't own anything there. We will give you advance and we will buy it from you. We will buy the end product from you. So here, when you're looking at ROA, their ROE keeps on increasing because they're not adding to the assets, they're getting returns, right? So these companies will give huge payouts because they don't need the money. Maybe the parent also wants. So these companies gives out huge amounts of dividends. So what do you do with the dividend? Let's say you're a 35-year-old, 38-year-old professional, or you're working somewhere. You have huge other income with which you're living. You have a surplus even from what you're earning. So this dividend, let's say your dividends are 3 lakhs a year from all the companies, that is surplus and that is sleeping in your savings bank account and you're seeing what else to buy, right? So you call your broker and say, what else should I buy? I'm assuming he's a direct equity investor and not a mutual fund investor. So, and he has to look for a new share and then he says, buy more of the same share. He says, no, that I already have, which is a very wrong way of looking at it. Now, instead, if you decide that this 3 lakhs is coming from my portfolio of 7 shares, I will just buy those shares. I've got 30,000 dividend from Colgate, I'll buy 30,000 worth of Colgate. I've got 80,000 dividend from Supreme, I will buy Supreme. I will brainlessly buy the same shares because the more dividend that I get, the weight of that share in my portfolio will go up. I have taken a lot of trouble to choose that portfolio. I know it's a good portfolio, and the day I decide I want to sell off that share for whatever reasons, dividends won't come. So till the dividends come, it means I love that share and therefore it is there in my portfolio. So buying more of it at that price, you don't worry too much about the price because over a 30-year period, 40-year period, the price at which you buy doesn't really matter. What really is making money for you is the N, the number of years for which you have held. The total return from shares like NTPC and all would be much higher than many of the other companies which don't have so much of high dividend payout. So many PSUs, if you see the return which looks like, oh, it has gone from 75 rupees or 80 rupees to 220 over an 8-year period, it does not look like a great share, but every year it has been giving you 8 rupees, 9 rupees, 10 rupees dividend. So on a 70 rupee share, when you got 10 rupees dividend, that was a huge dividend deal. You use the 10 rupees and bought more shares, right? So the number of shares go up. This is exactly like mutual fund units. When the unit prices are low, you obviously get more units. So you decide every year I have 10 lakhs to invest plus 3 lakhs of dividend, which means I have 13 lakhs to invest. This 13 lakhs I'll put it into the same shares. So on this,
your position in the chair will keep going up.
Will keep going up. Your portfolio size goes up. Your portfolio sizing also doesn't matter if all the companies are paying good dividends. Those companies which don't pay good dividends are showing show up as the laggards, but there the price rise may be higher because they're growing fast, right? So a company which I like, which is growing fast, is not paying me dividends, but it's good because they are able to use the money more smartly. But this company is paying me dividend and it is getting a better return on their capital employed and on their equity, so let me buy more of that share. So this means every year you don't have to look for new shares to buy.
You are a heavy believer in DRIP.
I am a heavy believer in DRIP and in SIP, provided the person who is buying knows how to pick their portfolio. Because I can give you an example saying Larsen & Toubro, HUL, Colgate, Siemens. But remember, these are what is called hindsight bias and survivor bias. Because if you had done the same thing in an RK or some share like that, it would have gone down, Satyam, it would have gone down the drain. So assuming you have good portfolio picking skills, DRIP and SIP will work. But that is a basic assumption. If you don't know that, go to mutual funds. But if you know how to pick a good portfolio and stick with it, both DRIP and SIP will work.
You have actually talked about SIP in stock. But do you think it makes sense to do SIP in stock as much as it makes sense to do SIP in a mutual fund?
No, it does
not. Why? Why not?
Because two things will happen. The assumption is you know how to pick stocks and you have to pick stocks today, right? You don't have to, 20 years later only you will know whether you are right or wrong. So 10 years back, if you had picked Larsen & Toubro or HUL or Colgate, you would have made money. Supreme, you would have made money. But there would have been bad shares which you picked which didn't make money. And there could be some long periods of time when your theory would be tested, right? Lupin went from 700 to 70 back to 700. Would you have stayed on the whole course of 700 to 70 to 700? May not be. From 700, you would have done a SIP and you would have at 350 or something, you would have panicked and sold off the whole thing. Then watched it go down to 70 and been very happy that it happened. Then again, you would have gone back to 700. If you can't take that, so it's much easier to do a DRIP and SIP in a mutual fund. But in a mutual fund, when you grow for the growth option, the DRIP is already happening, then you just do your SIP. But for people who know how to pick stocks and who build stock, and there are many people watching this video who believe that they should create their own portfolios, for them, assuming either their portfolio manager is picking or they are themselves picking, for them, DRIP and SIP will work. For those who don't know how to pick stocks, even the buying the stock may be wrong. So for them, DRIP and SIP won't work. For those who know, both.
It has to happen in the right place. It can't happen in any place. Whereas in mutual fund, you don't have that problem.
You don't have that problem. The fund manager is doing the DRIP and you are doing the SIP.